السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ثم أما بعد Welcome back تفسير جزء تبارك We're discussing today Surah al-Muddathir May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who listen to the speech and follow the best of it Ya رب العالمين We're going to recite inshallah ta'ala from ayah number 30 through 37 أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم عليها تسعة عشر وما جعلنا أصحاب النار إلا ملائكة وما جعلنا عدتهم إلا فتنة للذين كفروا ليستيقن الذين أوتوا الكتاب ويزداد الذين آمنوا إيمانا ولا يرتاب الذين أوتوا الكتاب ولا يرتاب الذين أوتوا الكتاب والمؤمنون وليقول الذين في قلوبهم مرض والكافرون ماذا أراد الله بهذا مثلا كذلك يضل الله من يشاء ويهدي من يشاء وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَمَا هِيَ إِلَّا ذِكْرَى لِلْبَشَرِ كَلَّا وَالْقَمَرِ وَاللَّيْلِ إِذْ أَدْبَرِ وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرِ إِنَّهَا لَإِحْدَى الْكُبَرِ نَذِيرًا لِلْبَشَرِ لمن شاء منكم أن يتقدم أو يتأخر Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Muddathir عليها تسعة عشر What's the meaning of عليها تسعة عشر? Over it are 19 And what does that exactly mean? For those who have been with us from last session We were discussing the description of Jahannam That came earlier As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking about Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira when he was denying and rejecting the truth as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presented clearly in the Quran. He was the man who kind of fabricated the lie about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Quran when he says he must be a magician. And he says, in hada illa qawlul bashar, this must be the talk and the speech of a human being. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately didn't even have to refute his claim and his falsehood. He says, sa'uslihi saqar. He shall see his reward. He shall see the compensation for what he has said. سَأُصْلِهِ سَقَرْ I will roast him into Saqar, which is one of the name of Jahannam. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا سَقَرْ But what will explain to you what Saqar is like? No matter what I say, you're never going to be able to comprehend that until you see it. However, لَا تُبْقِي وَلَا تَذَرْ It doesn't, it neither leaves nor spares anything, like not even ashes. لَوَّاحَةُ لِلْبَشَرْ Scorched the skin. عَلَيْهَا تِسْعَةَ عَشَرْ One of the descriptions of Jahannam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about here. Over it are 19. Now, What is the meaning of 19? 19 means 19. So basically 10 plus 9. But what does it mean exactly? What's the essence of it? What is the meaning of saying 19? When it comes to the meaning of saying 19, there are a lot of interpretation from the ulama. Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention that they were 19? The explanation came afterwards. But that number specifically in terms of why 19, none of the ulama can say why specifically 19. Allahu ta'ala alam. Allah Ta'ala alam. Why Allah subhanahu chose 19 specifically? Why not 15, 17, 10, 11? We don't know. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says 19 and there's a hikmah, there's a wisdom that we don't know. But Allah explains certain things for us at least to explain to us why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dedicate a specific number for Jahannam. He says afterwards, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ إِلَّا مَلَائِكَةً He says, and we have appointed none but angels as wardens of the fire. So when Allah says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ إِلَّا مَلَائِكَةً The first thing that comes to our mind here is the word أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ أَصْحَاب in the Arabic means companionship. So we say the companions of Jahannam. صُحْبَ means companionship, which means actually attachment. Or it means assignment. Because once you have something that is attached to something else, it becomes more like suhba, like attachment. And in this case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word ashab al-nar because in the Arabic language, whenever you wanted to mention something and attach it to something else, you say sahib. For example, if someone owns a house, we say sahib al-dar. the man who owns the house, or the companion of the house, or the assigned person for the house. So that's what it means. So when Allah says, Ja'alna ashab an-nar, He subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about they've been assigned. This is assignment right now, dedication. And the sahib of an-nar, ashab an-nar, they were dedicated for the fire. Their job is to be assigned for the fire and be there as wardens of an-nar, ashab an-nar. And of course, ashab plural of sahib. So therefore we know 19 is plural over here, so it meant to be more than one. Ashab an-nar, these are the wardens of Jahannam. An-nar is of course fire, and one of the names of it, Jahannam, and Saqar, and so on. And Allah says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ إِلَّا مَلَائِكَ, that we made ashab an-nar, we only made them into malaika. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, we have appointed none but angels as warders of fire. So Allah says we have none but angels. The word, the article, the Arabic language actually, illa, which is basically, which is over here, illa, that's an istithna, exception. What kind of exception is that? There are different categories of exceptions in the Quran and the Arabic language. One of them is istithna un nawa, which means an exception of type or category. What does that mean? That means there is no association between what you're exempted from the one that exempted from. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about completely different type. Like no matter what you think about them, they're a whole different category. وَمَا جَعَلْنَا أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ إِلَّا مَلَائِكَ. Like out of all the types of Allah's creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose a unique creation to be assigned as wardens for the fire. And these are malaika. Means they're angels. We say angels, we know that the angels are the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah azza wa jal created them as from a special light. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them into a specific creation that is dedicated to the worship of Allah azza wa jal. They don't disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in any way. They're, in terms of their creation, in comparison to the human beings, they have the perfection of in terms of their ibadah, their ta'ah, their worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're pure creation, they don't commit sins, so they're infallible in that sense. And they only do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assigned for them. So these are the angels. And Allah says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ إِلَّا مَلَائِكَ. However, He said, we made them angels. Okay, so this is now the general description of angels. But what about the specific description of the angels of fire? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran in different ways. He says, قَالَ فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَ سَنُدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَ. They will name Zabaniya in Surah Al-Alaq. And the story of Surah Al-Alaq, this act comes when Abu Jahl was mocking the Prophet ﷺ about, you know, the angels of fire, which they were actually mentioned, they were 19. So Abu Jahl, when he heard that number, he said to the people of Mecca, what are you guys are afraid of? You're so many. I mean, every 10 of you can handle one of them. Every 100 of you, you're so many, 100 can handle one of them. That's what he thought, because eventually you can, easy, the number is easy. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِلَّا مَلَائِكَ. You talk about angels. They're not humans. They're angels, which is one of them can destroy not just Mecca, the people of Mecca, the whole thing. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, illa malaika. So when Abu Jahl was thinking that it's actually going to be easy, so Allah says, فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَ. Let him call his nadi, his all his people, all his group. سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَ. We shall call against him as Zabaniya. And as Zabaniya are the guardians of Jahannam, and these are al-malaika. And what's the meaning of Zabaniya? Zabaniya means those who push. Basically, they say, يَدْفَعُونَهُمْ إِلَىٰ جَهَنَّمْ. They will push them into Jahannam, like this, kind of like march them straight into Jahannam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentioned the angels of Jahannam. قَالَ in Surah Az-Zumar, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَىٰ جَهَنَّمَ زُمَرًا. When the kuffar, the disbelievers were steered into towards Jahannam. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا فُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا. Until they arrived at Jahannam, the doors and the gates of Jahannam were opened for them. وَقَالَ لَهُمْ خَزَنَتُهَا. And the guardians or the wardens of Jahannam, they were telling the people as they were coming into Jahannam, أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِنْكُمْ يَتْلُونَ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ رَبِّكُمْ وَيُنْذِرُونَكُمْ لِقَاءَ يَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا. Didn't you receive messengers from amongst yourselves who warned you against this day? That's what you're suffering right now from? So of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named them here Khazana Jahannam. Khazana, which means the wardens or the guardians of Jahannam. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the people, the angels of Jahannam, as in Surah Al-Tahrim, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nara. All you who believed, guard yourself, protect yourself and your family, nara, against Jahannam, against the fire of hell. وقودها الناس والحجارة, the fuel of which is people and rocks and stones. عليها, assigned on it or for it. ملائكة غلاظ شداد, angels who are stern, شداد, and it means tough, means they don't even laugh, they don't even joke, they don't even smile. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم, they would never disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They fulfill all the commands of Allah azza wa jal, ويفعلون ما يؤمرون, and they will fulfill all the commands that come to them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Among all these angels of Jahannam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assigned one to be the main warden of Jahannam. And Allah named him Malik, as mentioned in Surah Al-Zukhruf. وَنَادَوْ يَا مَالِكُ لِيَقْضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكَ. The people of Jahannam, they would call upon Malik, the guardian, the main warden of Jahannam, says, Malik, Ya Malik, calling him, Oh Malik, لِيَقْضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكَ. Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let your Lord finish us. Can we just finish this? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that he will answer them by saying, قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. You'll stay there. You're going nowhere. Like, you will suffer the punishment for what you have done to yourself. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned specific description about the angels of Jahannam. So now when Allah says 19, obviously we said that the number in itself was mentioned for a specific reason. And what is that? What is the illa of mentioning this number of the angels of Jahannam? قال الله تبارك وتعالى وَمَا جَعَلْنَا عِدَّتَهُمْ إِلَّا فِتْنَةً الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَمَا جَعَلْنَا عِدَّتَهُمْ إِلَّا فِتْنَةً لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. So the real reason why the number was mentioned like this as 19 is fitna, which means it's what going to be as a trial, a test. And we cause their number to be stumbling block for those who disbelieve, so that those given the scripture may attain certainty, and those who believe may increase in their iman, and those given the scripture and the believers may not doubt, and those in whose heart is sickness and marad, and the unbelievers may say, what did Allah intend by this parable? Thus Allah leads astray whom He wills, and He guides whom He wills, and none knows the soldiers of your Lord except He, and it is but a reminder to the humans. So let's go back again to the words in Arabic, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا عِدَّتَهُمْ. Allah says, عِدَّتَهُمْ is the number, the count. So why 19 specifically? He says, illa, number one, except, number one, fitna. Fitna, which means what? A test for these people. Or a trial for them. Or just for the disbelievers, to be confused and to be tried by this. Why so? Because they, Attar ibn Ashur, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the number, obviously, what is expected when Allah says the angels will be 19? What is expected? People will ask questions. What are these questions? Now here's some of these questions. People will say, okay, but hold on a second. Why not thousands? Why not thousands? I mean, why 19? Why not thousands? If Jahannam requires a lot of attention, why not thousands? We say the reason for that, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to show the people He doesn't need the help of anybody. He doesn't need the help of anybody. So He doesn't need thousands. He doesn't need even hundreds. But why 19? We don't know specifically. But it's just a show that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's power doesn't require any assistance. That number is for a specific reason, we don't know. The second thing they say, al-malaika, one of them could be sufficient. One could be sufficient, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about Jibreel, when Jibreel came to destroy the Qawm Lut. With the tip of his wing, he finished the whole town and the whole village. So we don't need that many, but still we don't know why 19, because one could be sufficient. And that's what people might ask the question. And some people, of course, they say, well, this is actually just to show the people of Mecca, the non-believers, how short they come to understand the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if they don't believe. Because if you believe the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the number doesn't matter to you. Because you know, Allah is so powerful subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when He says 19, it must be a wisdom or a hikmah. But because they don't believe, so they focus on the number itself and try to make a controversy about it. And subhanAllah, this is exactly what happens in our time today. When people don't understand something, what do? They create controversy, just to deflect basically the people from understanding the main point out of it. And they fabricate, they make assumptions, and they just start believing in these assumptions, and they move on. The exact same way happening today as well. Probably maybe some of you watched the presidential debate yesterday between Joe Biden and President Trump, and you have seen for yourself how the debate was going, if you watch it, obviously. And if you've seen how, subhanAllah, when it comes, the truth is clear. The truth is clear. But people don't want to believe in it, or at least they don't want to actually accept it or submit to it. because they're going to lose a lot. That's what they feel. They would lose a lot if they actually submitted to the truth. And here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also saying that He will do that in order to differentiate between the believers, the non-believers, and those who have sickness in their hearts. So, who are these categories? He says, إِلَّا فِتْنَةً لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. So it's going to be a trial for those who disbelieve. And obviously the people of Mecca, they came and they rejected that message altogether. But then there is another group. Also, لِيَسْتَيْقِنَا. ليستيقن. And what is يستيقن? يستيقن comes from يقين or استيقن. And استيقن has the alif, seen, ta. In the Arabic language, any word that starts with alif, seen, ta is usually, these three letters together means soliciting something. And when we talk about يقين over here, so you're soliciting يقين. And what is يقين? Certainty. So here, for those who are looking for certainty, looking for the proof, looking for the truth, for those who are looking for it, they'll find it. That's what it means. They'll find it in there. He says, لِيَسْتَيْقِنَا. So those who are looking for the truth, they will find it, لِيَسْتَيْقِنَا. But who are they? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned one specific category. الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ. Those who've been given the scripture. What does that mean? The Jewish people, the Christians? And then, but hold on a second. يَسْتَيْقِنَا, what does that mean? The ulama of tafsir, they say, because it was mentioned in their scripture, that is actually verse 19. And there's even a hadith. In a certain Tirmidhi, although there's a dispute about the authenticity of the hadith itself, Jabir radiallahu anhu was reporting that some of the people from the people of the scripture, they asked the people, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, how many are the guardians of Jahannam? And the Sahaba didn't know that. So they told the Prophet, they said, we don't know. We can ask our Prophet. So when they came and asked the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu revealed the ayah for them, which means matches what actually they have in their scriptures. And the narration, the Prophet ﷺ, actually he did this. He says, they're like this, 10, and then he did this, 19. Some they say, well, wait a second. I mean, this ayah was revealed in Mecca, right? So how is that now being something that happened with the people of the book? Well, the people of the book, or the Arabs, were actually familiar with the people of the book. They traveled to Yemen, they meet them there. They traveled to Asham, they meet them there. They were on the way also in Medina, in Khaybar. So they met the Jewish people and the Christians in Yemen as well too. So they're familiar with that. So perhaps, maybe, when the news spread about the Prophet ﷺ, that they asked some of the merchants of the mushrikeen, says, hey, ask this man who says so-and-so about the guardians of Jahannam, and let's see what he has. And the Prophet ﷺ gave the answer that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him, which matches what they had in their scripture. Okay, but now we have a dilemma over here. If you go and ask people from the people of the book, Jewish community or the Christians, you know, if you know anybody, ask them, how many are the guardians of Jahannam? I did actually, before the class, I asked one of my friends from the neighbor church. I said, listen, I have a question for you guys. Do you have in any of your resources anything that says about the scriptures, about the guardians of Jahannam, if they were 19 or so? They don't have it, or at least he said that did not actually, they don't recall they have it in their scripture, they have it in their hands. So what does that mean? Now, here's the thing. Today's Christianity was not the same Christianity when the Quran was revealed back then. Why? For two things. Number one, when Quran was revealed in Mecca, the predominant denomination of Christianity of the time was actually an Eastern Christianity. The Nestorians, the Jacobites, and other denominations was today, they're considered extremely minority within the Christian, actually, community. They exist in different places. Today, maybe northern Iraq, somewhere in Syria, and other places. And they have their main church here in Chicago, as a matter of fact. But they're a minority within the big community of Christians. So I said to him, I said, maybe this is the case. He says, yeah, that is true, because he says, I remember reading in the history of the Bible and the gospel, that during that time, there were multiple versions of the Gospels that were circulating. And obviously, when they canonized the Gospels to be four, there were still some other Gospels among other minorities with among Christians. Perhaps those were the scriptures that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was referring to, because when the Quran was revealed, they were the Christians that the Arab and the Muslims at that time were dealing with. Catholicism, relatively speaking, is relatively new compared to that, actually, Eastern Church, let alone, of course, the Protestants and so on. So as a result, when you say, but hold on a second, the Quran said there were 19, and the people of the book will confirm that, and if you ask them today, they would say, no, that is not true. Again, because what we're dealing with is different. The second reason, obviously, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the the people of the book, they continue to alter that. And obviously with the translation keep changing and changing and changing, perhaps somewhere it was lost in translation as well. So Allah Ta'ala alam. But Allah Subhanahu says, لِيَسْتَيْقِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ. So those who receive the book, they will find a certainty in there. And لِيَسْتَيْقِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ وَيَزْدَادَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِيمَانًا. And those who have faith, which means the believers, the Muslims, when they accepted Islam, يَزْدَادَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِيمَانًا. When they know that the people of the book would confirm what they received from Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, their iman would increase. Meaning at least this is not, you know, something just new, even was sent to the prophets before us as well too. Now, why is that so important? Well, when the Prophet ﷺ was in Mecca, still, he loved to have some sort of similarity with the people of the book at that time. Why? Because now it's a new message for the people of Mecca, and the Prophet ﷺ, he loved to have some similarities with the people of the scripture because this comes from the same source, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, of course, might be some alteration with their messages, but at least if something matches, it would be good. Which is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Surah al-Rum, alif lam mim, ghulabat al-Rum fi adna al-ard, when the Rum were defeated by the Persians, the mushrikeen in Mecca, they were excited about it. Like they were excited about that, you know what, that they're fellow, you know, fire worshippers, they won against the people who believed in God in heaven. And Allah, the Prophet ﷺ was saddened by that defeat. But Allah gave him the news. فِي أَدْنَا الْأَرْضِ وَمِنْ بَعْدِ غَلَبِهِمْ سَيَغْلِبُونَ فِي بِضْعِ السِّنِينَ. It's okay. They were defeated in that land, but in a few years, they will win back. And they kept waiting and waiting until they won. And that was something pleasing to the Prophet ﷺ. But when the Prophet ﷺ moved to Medina, and now Islam became aziz, which means the message of Islam became strong and the community became strong, he didn't need that kind of, you know, similarity, or at least, you know, kind of like to coincide with them on these events and so on. But here Allah subhanahu says, وَيَزْدَادَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِيمَانًا. This ayah, according to Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, is a confirmation that al-Imanu yazidu wa yanqus. That al-Iman, faith, yazid wa yanqus. It increases and decreases. Some other Muslim, you know, interpretation, Muslim sects, they say, no, al-Iman is one unit. Al-Iman, in terms of its kayfiyya, it's one thing, whether you have it or you don't have it. But in terms of juz'iyyat, that's a different story, which means some portions of it, it means counting it, that's a different story. But here, according to Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, Ahlul Athar is that al-Imanu yazidu wa yanqus, faith and Iman increases and decreases, which means you have strong Iman and weak Iman. And there are many evidences for this. One of them is here. Allah says, وَيَزْدَادَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِيمَانًا. And those who have faith will increase in their faith. So their faith will increase. And if something increases, it has to decrease as well. How does al-Iman increase? Increase by worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Come closer to Allah azza wa jal. Doing good deeds. This is how your Iman increases. How does it decrease? By the opposite. Whether not doing good deeds at all or doing bad deeds. So the iman starts dipping and going down. So al-iman yazidu wa yanqus. And hadith of Prophet ﷺ says, al-mu'min al-qawi khayrun wa ahabbu ila Allah min al-mu'min al-da'if fi kullin khayr. The strong believer is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the weak believer. And Allah, the Prophet ﷺ says, wa fi kullin khayr, but there is always khayr in both. So sometimes the believer can have a strong iman or weak iman. So iman yazidu wa yanqus, increases or decreases. So As-Sahaba radiallahu anhu here, of course, they had the strength of their iman already. The base of it is there. But some events and some, of course, of their practice makes their iman increase. Similarly, with the yaqeen, the subject of certainty over here. Even certainty comes at different levels. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Surah At-Takathur, He says, كَلَّا لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمَ ثُمَّ لَتَرَوُنَّهَا عَيْنَ الْيَقِينَ ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. And our ulama, they say that here in this ayat, we have three levels of certainty. There's ilm al-yaqeen, the certainty of knowledge. Like if someone tells you something, you believe it. And that depends on the reliability of the source, obviously. So you're acquiring the certainty of knowledge. The second thing, no, I need the certainty of sight, because some people just to know is not sufficient. I need to see to believe. So that's the second level. Number three, some people it's not sufficient to see. I need to see more of it until it becomes haqq al-yaqeen. So we have the ilm al-yaqeen, the certainty of knowledge, the certainty of sight, and the certainty of experience. So which basically, you have to do more of it enough until I believe it. This happens in almost every interaction with human beings. Look between a husband and wife. If the husband and wife, they wish that their level of trust among themselves, which is yaqeen, basically the certainty, is based off their words. Like if I say something, you believe me in that. They wish they're at that level. But they say, no, I need to see to believe. But even when you start doing what you expect them to be actually evidence enough for you to believe, they won't feel comfortable to drop their guards down until they see enough of this to make them believe this is permanent, not temporary. So the same thing, al-yaqeen and al-iman, it's actually building blocks. You build it, and it takes some time to do that. But here's the thing, subhanAllah, what is so sad is that it takes time to build something, but it takes a split second to destroy it. And al-iman can be destroyed, you know, easily if the person doesn't keep paying attention and guard their structure. Same thing with their yaqeen and their certainty. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that strong yaqeen, strong certainty in our hearts and our iman, ya Rabbil Alameen. So, قال وَيَزْدَادَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِيمَانًا. What is al-iman anyway? Al-iman, it's basically, it's a tasdiqu fil qalb. You have the confirmation and the conviction in the heart. And the affirmation by tongue when you say it. And also the confirmation through your actions. So you have conviction in the heart, affirmation through the tongue, and confirmation through the actions as well too. This is what your iman. But of course, so if you believe in something, it has to come out on your mouth. Like if you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to make dhikr of Allah azza wa jal. And if you truly believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you believe in Jahannam and Jannah and this and that, then it has to show in your actions. And the more you do, hopefully with conviction, with good intention, the more your iman will increase. May Allah subhanahu increase our iman, ya Rabbil Alameen. قال الله تعالى ولا يرتاب الذين أوتوا الكتاب. What else? Why the numbers are 19? So that the people of the book, the people of scriptures, once again we go to the same controversy over here. قال لا يرتاب. They won't have any doubt. They will never have any doubt. So their iman will increase, their yaqeen will increase, and also will have absolutely no doubt after that. والمؤمنون as well will have no doubt. Why so? Why so? Because when do people remove doubts and remove assumptions? When they have proof and evidence. You see, uninformed people equal to misinformed. And if you don't give people information, they will make assumptions. What does that exactly mean? If people don't have information about something, enough information, they will have to make assumptions. Why? Because Allah designed the mind and the human brain always to make meaning for things. It has to make meaning. If it doesn't make any sense to you, you're going to have to create something to make sense to you. So that's exactly the same thing over here. Unless you have enough proof or enough knowledge or enough evidence, whether it's actually something that you learn, something that you see, that will be sufficient for you to remove all these apprehensions, all these doubts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that here, we will make their yaqeen to increase. Their certainty will increase. The iman of the believers will also increase. And they would never have doubt. Why? Because they would have the proof that it's true. وَلَا يَرْتَابَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ and the believers. And then he says, وَلِيَقُولَ الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ وَالْكَافِرُونَ مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا. What does that mean over here? So, when it comes to saying وَلِيَقُولَ الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ, this lam over here is called lamul aqiba, which is basically like the ramification and the end results. Like the end result of all these evidences and all these proofs, still the non-believers and those who have weakness and have a sickness in their hearts, they will still not believe and they will still ask the question, what Allah needs out of this example? What's the point of this example? So here, وَلِيَقُولَ الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ. What's the meaning of those who فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ? Some of us, they say these are the hypocrites, the munafiqeen. But Wallahu ta'ala alam, according to Tahir ibn Ashur, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says that cannot be actually the hypocrites and the munafiqeen, unless you say that this ayah was given the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a prophecy about the future. Something's going to happen in the future, because in Mecca there was no munafiqeen. Whether you have believers or non-believers, that's it. Because no one wants to hide their faith and show in a circumstance like it occurred actually in Mecca. But in Medina they existed. So some of the ulama, they say that was just more like telling the Prophet ﷺ about what's going to happen in the future. However, wallahu alam, the proper interpretation of this ayah, fi qulubihim marad, among the people of Mecca themselves. Like who? Like al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. The earlier ayat, we're talking about him. We mentioned this story last week. So Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira was the man, when he heard the Quran, he came describing it in a way that was very impressive, but scared the people of Mecca. And they said, Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, he lost his mind. And he is one of the elders and the leaders of Mecca. He's one of the most prominent figures of Mecca. And if the people of Mecca, they hear him saying these things, it's gonna actually cause him to probably maybe to think that he lost it, he became Muslim, and they're going to follow his path. So they went with him and they insisted on him to say something bad about the Quran. So he started pondering and reflecting, and eventually he came up with the idea, you know what, it's magic. So he came up with that. So this is the man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described as fi qalbihi marad. This man fi qalbihi marad. And other ulama, they say on the tafsir as well, Al-Akhnas ibn Shariq, who also had this inclination to believe, and he loved the Quran, he loved the message of the Quran, but still they denied it because of their desire for the dunya. And that's the blocked them from believing. So if they have in their hearts, they have sickness. Others, like other kuffar, actually, they didn't even have any kind of, you know, inclination to the Quran. No matter what, they completely denied it. As Allah described in subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, وَاتْقَالُوا اللَّهُمَّ إِنْ كَانَ هَذَا الْحَقُّ مِنْ عِنْدِكَ فَارْسْتَ فَأَمْطَرْ عَلَيْنَا حِجَارَةً مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. They said, Ya Allah, if this is true coming from you, we want you to shower us with rocks and stones, like just finish us. To that level of, a'udhu billah, of denial and rejection, that they insisted that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish us, you just punish us. If it's true, just punish us right away. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rahim, He gave them a chance after chance after chance. And some of these people, actually, as a matter of fact, they became Muslim afterwards. So once again, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was mentioning here, ba'dhum qal fi qulubi marad, not the hypocrites of munafiqeen, but they are the people of Mecca who were inclined, but they could not. They didn't want to lose what they earned in this dunya. So therefore, they stayed actually among themselves, kind of like always wishy-washy, not confirming their iman or their kufr. So kind of like kept among the people, moving, enjoying their privileges there in Mecca. قَالَ وَالْكَافِرُونَ. And those who disbelieved. What did they say? They say, مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا. A question. مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا. Their question actually is, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala need of this example? What does it mean exactly? No, were they really asking, looking for an answer? They were not asking to look for an answer. That question is للتعجيز, like just like seriously? What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want of this example? Why 19? Why is he's telling us this? Because they say, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable of all things, why then 19? So our ulama, they gave actually some answers to this. Number one, say the reason why is because it's to show us اختلاف العقول في تلقي الحقائق والانتفاع بها. According to Tahir ibn Ashur رحمه الله تعالى, he says that is an evidence. It shows us that how people interact with the truth and the proof. Like, even though it's clear, you can see it with your own eyes, you can even touch it, but there are people who will come to deny it still. So to think that everybody is going to be reasonable and sensible, and once again, I can't stop actually bringing the presidential debate that happened yesterday as an example, because it is so clear that some people, even though they see the truth, they can feel it, they live it, but they still want to deny it. Why so? So they say there are three reasons for that. Number one, al-kibru wal-mukabara, arrogance. They're very arrogant, they don't want to admit. Not at all, because they don't want to be defeated. That's number one. Number two, they say, al-hasad, envy. So in heart, they have so much envy, you know, for the one who's been privileged with that, and therefore they were not going to believe that. Just like Abu Jahl, when he was asked, why wouldn't you believe in Muhammad? He says, listen, you don't think I believe that he was saying is true? I do, but you know what? He is from such and such, Banu Hashim, and we are from this. So speak about the two kind of, the two major competing clans in Quraysh, in Mecca. So they said, we're going to feed the Hujjaj, we'll feed the Hujjaj. We're going to give them water, we give them water. We're going to do this, we're going to do that. Now they're saying they have a prophet. Where are we going to get a prophet from? Wallahi, he says, I swear we're not going to believe in their prophet at all. So it was inad, and it was hasad and envy that they have a privilege of having a prophet among themselves by the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, gharad al-dunya, looking for the matters of dunya. So some people, they know this is true, but they won't believe it at all. Why? Because their heart is attached to this dunya, and you don't want to lose the privilege, the name, the fame, the wealth, whatever that is. Because they're thinking of this to be actually the benefit for them, not knowing it's temporary, or at least they know, but at least they want to enjoy it. Subhanallah, a lot of people, because of that, they lose the opportunity to say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. One of them, as a matter of fact, is Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, on his deathbed. For his name and his reputation, he refused to say La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So here, the question again about why they're denying it is not because they're denying it, it's they know it's true, but they're asking this mukabara and inad. Like they're just kind of being so stubborn, they're so arrogant, and it says, how come Allah bring an example like this? قال الله عز وجل كذلك يضل الله من يشاء ويهدي من يشاء. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thus يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ means cause people to go astray, and He also guides people to that right path subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's the meaning of Allah Azza wa Jal يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ and يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ? What does that exactly mean when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said so? So يُضِل meaning to lead astray. Does it mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forces people to go astray? No, that's not what it means here. What it means is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who created the asbab, the means that leads people to go astray, or the means that leads people to be guided. And He gave them the free choice. He gave them the ability to make their own decisions. He gave them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, aql by which they can comprehend and make choices for themselves, and the free will. So we always mention that in order to explain that actually for people to understand that, here's how it goes. So I want to just kind of like, if we draw over here, so if we make two circles here, the big circle is called the allowed. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed to happen. This is called mashi'atullah, Allah's will to allow everything to happen in His kingdom. Like what? He's speaking about having good and evil, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Marriage and divorce, love and hate, peace and war, sin and virtue, all these things, all these contrasts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created all of this as part of the test, and He put it into the allowed circle. Then out of all these things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected the commands circle. The first one, the ulama, they call it al-mashi'atul kawniyah, which means the divine mashi'ah, will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is al-mashi'atul shar'iyyah, which means Allah's commandments. So the divine and the commandments. So the divine one is by his wisdom subhanahu wa ta'ala, He allowed all this to exist as part of the test. And then He selected out of all of these things what is good for you. So He chose for you peace, love, goodness, virtue, all of this, and He put them in the circle. And then He sent to you subhanahu wa ta'ala prophets and messengers. He sent you books, He sent you guides, He sent you scholars, He sent you, and He gave you the, of course, your free will and intellect by which you can make assessment and make your decision. And He orders all of us to move from the allowed circle to the command circle. Those who enter the command circle, they are guided and they'll be rewarded Jannah. Those who stay out of it and stay here, they're not going to go out of here. They can't go out of here because you can only be within these two circles. So if you're not in this circle, you're in this circle. So you're in this circle by His general will of allowing this to happen. But He doesn't love it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't love misguidance for us. And He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, wants us to be in the command circle over here. So therefore, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, when He says, كَذَلِكَ يُضِلُّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. So He subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's speaking right now about they choose for themselves to be misguided, and some others they choose for themselves to be guided. By what? By following what Allah has created of the means of guidance or misguidance. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُ. Who knows about the junood of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala? So this is actually an explanation about now conclusion. So let them get confused. Let the controversy go on. The disbelievers will disbelieve. Those who have sickness in their hearts will have some doubts. Those who have the people of the scripture, they will reflect on their scripture and they see the truth about it, and the believers or the iman increases. So the people's position from the truth is actually, it's a matter of perspective. The truth is the truth, it doesn't change. There's no such thing as alternative facts. Facts are facts, the truth is truth. That's it, it's one thing. Now, how do you look at it? That's a perspective. And obviously, this is where people unfortunately go astray or stay guided based on following the rules. If you don't follow the rules for, you know, being guided, you're going to end up being misguided. So you can't twist the rules of guidance hoping that will get you where you're supposed to go, which is guidance. And the same thing over here, Allah says, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُ. Only your Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala, would know these soldiers or these actually junud of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means the creation of Allah, azza, that He assigned to work for Him. Now, but Allah says, wait a second, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُ, that only your Lord would know these junud. So He called them junud رَبِّكَ, the soldiers of your Lord. That is tashrif, like the raising his their status, to honor them with this, that they belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, Rabbika, speaking of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because the accusation came against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that who gave them that revelation. So to give him that support from Allah azza wa jal, as support him through these soldiers, He says, don't worry. These are the soldiers of your Lord, which means He's going to give them, they're going to support you, they're going to be with you, and He can assign them to help you and assist you as well too, in refutation to the claim of these people. And here the junud of Rabbika subhanahu wa ta'ala, it means everything. It means actually some of the ulama, they say it means also the wind, it means the angels, it means the weather, the heat, the circumstance, whatever Allah subhanahu choose actually as to manifest his power and his majesty subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, none will know these soldiers but Allah azza wa jal. But don't we know enough about them already? So we know that they're 19. We know that they're stern. We know that they're strong and powerful. We know that it's called Zabaniya and so on. So what does that mean then? What does that knowledge mean? The details. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us just general information or general knowledge of these junud or these angels. But He did not give us all the details. Like the actual description. How do they look like? We have some narrations from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about them. Speaking as a matter of fact about the description of the people of Jahannam. Not the angels of Jahannam. The people of Jahannam. So the people of Jahannam, Allah subhanahu and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, قال ضرس الكافر أو ناب الكافر كجبل أحد في النار كجبل أحد, that the molar and the tooth of the non-believer on the day in Jahannam will be the size of the mountain of Uhud. That is now the non-believers. Can you imagine the size of the angels then, the guardians of Jahannam? So that's obvious. Differently, it's massive. Also, the size, the distance between the two shoulders, the shoulder blades between the disbelievers, says masir thalathati ayyam, like the distance of walking for 3 days. This is how massive size the human being will be on that day. You can imagine now the angels. We don't know the full description of these angels. Also, when it comes to saying that there are 19, is it just 19 angels, 19 categories, 19 ranks, 19 officers, and they have thousands and thousands of angels that work also underneath their supervision? Wallahu a'lam, it seems that they are actually ranks, and therefore there's so many angels work with them. Because in Hadith Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to Hadith Abi Huraira, Muslim Imam Ahmad, Hadith Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned about Jahannam, that Jahannam, laha sab'una zimam, it has 70, it's going to be coming, 70,000 actually ropes and chains will be brought in front of the people, and holding each one of them would be actually 70,000 angels. So count that, it's talking about massive numbers of angels. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ, except who subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about the details of these angels or the junud. وَمَا هِيَ إِلَّا ذِكْرَ لِلْبَشَرِ, and this is, here means this is, what is that? ذِكْرَ, reminder, لِلْبَشَر, to remind al-bashar, human beings. Reminding al-Bashar, here, first of all, what is here over here? Some ulama, they say, actually, this is the controversy over the numbers. Some ulama, they say, no, actually, this is Saqar itself, Jahannam itself. Some of ulama, they say, no, actually, this is Junud Rabbika, the soldiers of your Lord. Some ulama, they say, no, it's everything that was mentioned earlier. That is all is dhikra, which means a reminder, lil-Bashar, to the people, to mankind. So it's not just to the people of Mecca, to mankind. And also now, expanding that the da'wah of the Prophet ﷺ was not exclusively for the people of Mecca. What comes next after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refuted now the accusation and the claim of the people of Mecca, comes now a warning for them. This warning probably was actually the first official warning that the people of Mecca received from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kalla wal qamar. He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, Nay, the word kalla in the Arabic language, they call it actually an article of rada', which means scolding. Scolding somebody and rebuking somebody. Kalla, no, that's what it means. Wal qamar, I swear to you by the moon. Wal layli idh adbar, and I swear to you by the night as it retreats. Was subhi idha asfar, and I swear to you by the morning as it brightens. What does that mean? These are now three things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, he swore by three things. Number one, al-qamar, he swore by the moon. Number two, he swore by the night as it retreats. And number three, by the morning as it brightens. So he swore by one thing and two conditions. One thing, one item, an actual object, and two conditions. The object is the moon itself. The object is the moon itself. And the day and the night, or actually the break of dawn and the darkness of the night as it retreats, obviously, these are two conditions, alteration of the day and the night. What is so significant over here? Why would Allah subhanahu bring this as an example? First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not swear by anything unless it's significant. And everything Allah has created significant to us because it's His creation subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he has subhanahu wa ta'ala the absolute power to swear by whatever he wants to swear by. So he swears by al-qamar. But why al-qamar in particularly? Because al-qamar Allah mentioned in the Quran, gives nur. And what is nur? Light. That soft, beautiful light. It's not like the light of the sun that brings heat. No, it gives you the light that makes you see. Now, for us, we lost the connection with the moon in the modern time. Why? Unless you go to what they call them dark spots on earth. When you have absolutely no light pollution, only then you will appreciate the brightness of the moon when it's full at night. Because you will be able to see. Some of the ulama, they said they used to read books in the darkness of the night when the moon is full, obviously. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that, I swear to you by the moon. It's so bright, it gives you light. Why? Because now is a debate over darkness and light. It's about guidance and misguidance. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings these examples for the example of guidance and misguidance. He says, I swear to you about the moon. It's so clear. The light of the moon is so clear at night. Like, wouldn't you see it? Isn't it so bright and clear to you? Like, this is as bright as the brightness of the moon at night. And then Allah says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذْ أَدْبَرْ, and I swear to you by the night when it retreats. Basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if He's telling the people of Mecca, this darkness that you're living is coming to retreat. Why? Because as-subh, the morning, is going to be bright and it's coming soon. So here is more of like mention a short story for them about what's going to happen to you in the future. So I swear to you by the moon, when it's bright and clear. This is the truth, as clear as sighting the moon. And the moon was mentioned many actually different narration from the Prophet ﷺ in regards to clarity. As in hadith of Nabi ﷺ, when he spoke about seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannah for the believers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among them, ya Rabbil Alameen. To see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that suits His majesty. The Prophet ﷺ says, on the day of judgment, which is in Jannah, basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet ﷺ is mentioning, you will be able to see your Lord. كَمَا تَرَوْنَ He actually, as a matter of fact, the hadith begins by the Prophet ﷺ sitting with the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum in one of those beautiful nights when the moon was full. So the Prophet ﷺ says, when you look at this moon, do you kind of like push and scooch, you know, over to kind of see it, or you just look up and you see it clearly? This is, it's clear, obviously it's clear. You don't have to look, you know, to kind of push each other to see, because it's very clear and obvious. Because you shall have the clarity of sighting this moon. You shall have the same clarity of sighting the moon, and you shall have the clarity of sighting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner that suits His majesty. And obviously, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned this the same, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلْ أَعْلَى, that this truth is as clear as the brightness of the moon to you at night. The night is going to disappear at some point. This night will retreat. The night, meaning resembling the darkness over here, of the misguidance, was subh, and the morning will be basically the brightness that will take over that darkness of the night. The same thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned Surah Al-Duha for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wad-duha wal layli idha saja. I swear to you by the mid-morning hour, the forenoon. Wal layli idha saja, when the night takes over completely. مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. That, you know, your Lord did not forsake, had not forsaken or left you. It means he's still there with you. Even though it's dark, but it's still there, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always look for the bright spots. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now that he swore by three things. Now again, the moon, the night as it retreats, and the morning as it brightens. Then he brought right now al-muqsamu alayhi, which means what he's swearing for, subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّهَا لَإِحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. I swear to you, indeed, it is one of the greatest. Now, the English translation, they use the word greatest over here. But in the Arabic language, first of all, ihda, they say one. But it's not, as a matter of fact. Because one is wahid in the Arabic language. Ihda is ahad. And ahad means unique. It means it's unique. Something that is very, very unique. And obviously, when something is unique, it's one of a kind. That's what it means. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that, I swear to you, it is one of a kind. That's something that cannot be resembled by anything. That's what it means. Because if you say it's one of the greatest, what does that mean? So there are so many other things equivalent to it. So the translation is way off. The Arabic text says, إِنَّهَا لَإِحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. Indeed, it is the one and only. That's what it means. It is the most unique that stands by itself. Nothing resembles that. Al-Kubar. And Al-Kubar is actually plural of Kubra. And Kubra here means something that is extremely, extremely great and magnificent. Extremely great and magnificent. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that this is a unique, like it's a standout among all the greatest things that could happen to you. No matter what you think of, nothing is like that. إِنَّهَا لَإِحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. And he's speaking, of course, about what? About Jahannam, the ulama they say. Some of the ulama they say it's about Jahannam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that it's the greatest musibah that you will ever suffer or deal with. Nadhiran lil bashar, warning to the bashar, to the people. So he's mentioning subhanahu wa ta'ala the reason why we mention Jahannam in detail, saqar, and detailing it, and warning the people about denying the truth, even in the number of 19 of the angels. He says all of this is going to, you're going to suffer as a result of that, one of musibah, one of a kind of these catastrophes, of one of the greatest things you could ever imagine. Why? It's warning to the people. To warn the people about what's coming to them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after that he says, قَالَ why is it نَذِيرًا al-bashar? Why is it now warning to the people? لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَيَّتَقَدَّمَ وَيَتَأَخَرَ. To those among you who wish to advance or lag behind. So in the Arabic language, Allah says, لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ. Now here, if you remember earlier, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about guidance and misguidance what? يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That he caused people to go astray or other people to be guided. What does that mean? That means in the overall, the bigger circle. That Allah allowed this to happen subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here he says, لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ. He gave you now the will to choose. The will to choose what? To enter the small circle or stay out of it. So the big circle was the circle of the allowed, everything Allah allowed, guidance and misguidance. And then he put guidance in the small circle. And he told you to go in there by sending you all these prophets and messages and proofs and so on. And he says here, now you have the option, you have the choice, لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ, amongst you. And now he's speaking to them directly. Before he was speaking to them in the third person. And now he's giving them now a direct instruction. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ, for those of you, لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ, أَيَّتَقَدَّمَ, advance, أو يتأخر, lagging behind. Why do we, when we talk about guidance and da'wah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يتقدم ويتأخر, come forward, which means actually it means come forward, advance and come forward, or يتأخر, lag behind. Why so? Because remember, the Arabic language is a very visual language. If you don't actually try to visualize it clearly, you would miss the point. Usually, when someone is giving you something good, or something is actually, someone is telling you something nice and beautiful and good, what is the most common reaction of people towards that person? If someone calling you to something good and you like it, what do? You come forward to them. You advance towards them. And if you don't like it, what do? You turn away from them and you go back. So you retreat and you go, because I don't want to be part of this. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing this in that kind of context as well. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ وَيَتَقَدَّمْ, which means يَتَقَدَّمْ towards faith. Means advance towards believing, towards accepting that message. أَوْ يَتَأَخَّرْ, lagging behind and denying it and go backward and rejecting the message over here. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying here to us that all of this, talking about Jahannam, one more time, عَلَيْهَا تَسَعَةَ عَشَرْ, that will have 19 assigned to it. Who are they? Allah says they're angels. What kind of angels? We learned the description. Very unique description. But the number in itself, we don't even know why. Yes, we might say that the 19 ranks or 19 officers, and then you have all these actually other angels comes, you know, with them. But overall, we don't know the reason why the number 19, to be specific about it. But we know that was fitna lilladina kafaru, to those who disbelieved, and give yaqeen and uncertainty, increase their certainty for the people of the book. We talked about them from the people of the book of that time. وَيَزْدَادَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِيمَانًا. Those who have faith will have their iman to increase. And with the proof that we're given, all their apprehensions and all their doubts will be removed completely. But still, there will be some people with sickness in their hearts. قُلُوبُهُمْ مَرَضٌ وَالْكَافِرُونَ will always ask this question, مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا? Because the truth here becomes a matter of perspective. What does that mean? The evidence is there. In itself, is obvious and evident. But what makes people go astray or be guided is their perspective and their position from it. Some people, even though they know it's true, but because of their arrogance, because of their hasad and envy, and because of their love for the dunya, they will reject that. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَذَلِكَ يَدُ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That's why people go astray. And some people will be guided, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only Allah knows these true junoon and these soldiers of Allah azza wa jal. And that's a reminder for the people. And here's again, we have seen dhikr al-bashar over here, reminder to the people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeat that again, kalla wal qamar, making a comparison between the qamar, the moon, how clear it is, the truth is clear as the qamar, as the moon. Al-layl and al-nahar, to resemble guidance and misguidance, the darkness of the night will disappear at some point. وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرَ. Like this is giving the Prophet ﷺ a prophecy and good news in such a very early stage of the da'wah. The night will eventually retreat, and the subh, the morning, will be bright. إِنَّهَا لَيَحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. It is indeed one of these unique, of a, one of a kind, unique catastrophes that you can never imagine if it happens to you. Warning to the people, لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَيَتَقَدَّمَ وَيَتَأَخَّرَ. For those who desire, wish for themselves to advance and come closer to faith and accept, or lag behind and deny. May Allah subhanahu make us among those who come forward and accept that message, Ya Rabbil Alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill our heart with iman, Ya Rabbil Alameen. May Allah subhanahu make us among those who listen to the speech and follow the best of it. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.